collaboration with the group of Yuri Kivshar, as well as Sasha Pshekinsky and Nikita Alekhno, on quantum Hall phase, imagine an array of atoms interacting with photons. So Sasha, please, by the way, guys, do not hesitate to ask the question during the presentation. Depending on the situation, you can either just turn on your microphone and ask a question, or you can write it in comments, or you may raise a hand, not a hand, but a cup. But in this case, we just need to notice your cup. Okay, Sasha, please, I guess we can start.
Okay, thank you very much. So it's a very unusual experience for me. Just so we do this in English, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's do this. I will try to make it more like an offline seminar. So I will try to write some equations and to use not only prepared slides, but just a sort of a blackboard. So you should see this one note thing and with the title, and actually I also show the system that we consider. So it is this array of two-level atoms in a waveguide. So the system is very, very simple. We have a waveguide, one-dimensional, and in this one-dimensional waveguide, we have two-level atoms. So every atom can be in one of the two states, either at the bottom level or at the excited level. So bottom level is this. This is bottom. Okay. Bottom level. And here atom is in excited state. And I will consider the situation when only two of the atoms are excited. So basically, this is the whole setup. It's very, very simple. I have a periodic system of atoms in a waveguide. Atoms are closely spaced. The distance is much smaller than the wavelengths of light. So, okay. This will be some distance, and it will be much smaller than lambda. And I want to study eigenstates of this system and even to show that there is some topology due to interactions. So what are interactions and what is topology will be clear a little bit later. What I want to emphasize, usually people who study topological H-states or topologically non-trivial systems have to do something special. So in order to get non-trivial topology, people generally need, say, to apply magnetic field in a quantum Hall system, or people need to consider some special lattice. For instance, instead of, I don't know, periodic lattice, people consider some lattice with two changing spacings, like short, long, polyacetylene, or sometimes what people do, they use some specially engineered nonlinearities, which are, say, every second tunneling link is nonlinear. So usually people need some very special setups to engineer non-trivial topology. And the advantage of this proposal that I will try to explain today is that in order to introduce non-trivial topological phase, we don't need anything special. We don't need special lattice. We don't need external magnetic field. We don't need external time modulation. We don't need some special nonlinearity. So the system is very, very, very simple. It is just like a natural crystal, natural quantum crystal. It's array of closely spaced two-level atoms in a waveguide, and that's it. And hopefully by the end of the talk, I will be able to show you that even in such very, very simple system, interactions can induce topology. And this topology is really I write emerging, for me in this word, the word emerging is kind of important, because really we were not expecting any topology in this system. It was not clear from the beginning, but it's just there, like, I don't know, our neurons are simple, but our brain is complex. So the same happens here. The building blocks to level atoms are very, very simple, but the result is unusual. And okay, let's try to move on. If there are no questions, like general, I will try to explain you what is exactly quantum Hall phase. I will demonstrate here some quantum Hall phase, but first I want to provide some understanding what I mean by quantum Hall phase. Okay, so let me try to move forward, and I will try to draw some equations. So probably if you see my screen, you also see this grid, and I'm going to consider an electron on a two-dimensional quadratic lattice, and electron can jump from side to side. So, for instance, there is some tunneling, I have some atoms, and my electron can jump from the point xy to the point x plus 1 and y, or to the point y plus 1 x, and there are these jumps. So jump like this, jump like this, it also can jump backwards. So it's very, very simple problem, tight binding problem on a lattice. This is X and this is Y. So I want to consider this problem just for electron on this lattice. And I will start with writing a tight binding equation. So I will write it like this. Psi X minus 1 y plus psi x plus 1 y plus psi x y plus 1 plus psi x y minus 1 is equal to energy epsilon. What happened? I don't know. Something disappeared. It's very modern technology. Okay, so this is very, very simple equation. Just electron can hop from one side to another side. And that's it. So just two-dimensional tight binding model. In this model, I will get some band, and the width of this allowed band will be proportional to the tunneling amplitude, which is 1. So amplitude before each of this term is 1. What I want to do now, I want even to simplify this problem a little bit. I want to consider the situation when there is translational symmetry for the wave function. So I want to introduce some ky. And this means that my wave function is given by exponent of I ky y. And this is Px. And given this, I can rewrite my equation a little bit. It's very, very simple now. It will get a little bit more complicated later, but for now, I will just, instead of y minus 1, I will get phase e to ky minus 1. And the same will happen with y plus 1. So it is just e to minus i ky y psi Tx plus E K Y Y C X, and this is equal to. So far I have done nothing. I just have exploited translational symmetry of the problem. But I want to consider quantum hole. So this is a talk about interaction-induced quantum hole phase. So let's at least first start with quantum hole. And for this, I want to introduce magnetic field. So magnetic field will be perpendicular to my plane. So let's have here magnetic field BZ. And thus it will be a problem for electron. Yeah, Andrei, no why. That's correct. That's very, very good. So let's try to remove. Indeed, y is not necessary because it's just y minus one and y plus one. So indeed, y is to be removed. That's correct. And okay, so now I want to switch on magnetic field. So how I do this? Well, in order to, there are many ways to describe magnetic field for electron on a lattice. But what I will use is the so-called pyral substitution. And basically, first I will introduce some vector potential. I will say that, okay, B is curl of A, and A has only Y component, which is equal to BZ times X. So this is my vector potential. I describe my magnetic field by the vector potential, and it means that I need to introduce additional phase to the wave function. So basically, KY has to be replaced by KY plus AY. I forget about some charge of electron or speed of light. I don't want to take into account these factors. It's not so important. What is important is this term in additional term that I have to add to the wave vector. And thus, I have to add additional phase to my wave function. So here I will get I, then it will be B, X, and Y. It's like an Aronov boom phase. So I think I've added it correctly. So what I have done, I have taken this thing with AY, and I have added it to my wave function. And what does it mean? It means that there will be some additional phase for the hopping, which will be dependent on X. So basically, there will be some phase for these hoppings. And what does it mean? It means that here I actually have to add Bx. And here I will also have to add Bx to my equation. And I can even rewrite it in a nicer way. So it's the basic equation for the talk today. Very, very simple, but with many interesting consequences. I will write it like this. Cx minus one plus Cx plus one plus two cosine ky plus bx Cx is equal to epsilon Px. So it's a very, very important equation. It describes electron on a square lattice subjected to perpendicular magnetic field. And it's called Harper equation. Well, I guess many people obtained it, maybe independent, but usually it's called Harper equation. And 1955. So I want now to analyze this equation. So what will be the spectrum of the problem? Yeah, Maxim, so Ky is not multiplied. Just a second. Yeah, Ky is not multiplied by X. That's correct. That's correct. It's like this. And then I don't need actually these brackets. So I want to analyze this equation, but before I do it, there is a simple, let's like look at it from the bird's eye. So it equation, which is describes now a one-dimensional problem because all the movement is along X, but my potential is periodically modulated. So in this formulation, it's just a problem for a particle moving in a one-dimensional potential, and the energy is modulated periodically with X. So actually the same problem, absolutely the same problem, describes like I have a set of levels, and these levels are somehow, okay, I'll draw it maybe like this. So this is my cosine of Bx, and in every discrete point, I have an energy level. So here, 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 I have many energy levels, and particle can hop between these levels. And hopping amplitudes are the same, but the energies are modulated. So energies are modulated because of this cosine of Bx term. So let's now try to obtain the spectrum of this equation. And I want to do it first in the regime where magnetic field is small. So if magnetic field is small, say B much smaller than one, then in fact, what I see is that my potential is parabolic. So it is slowly changes with the coordinate, and it is parabolic. And I know the energy spectrum for a parabola. So the energy spectrum for a parabola is just a set of equidistant levels. So let's try to do it a little bit more formally. I can write something like this, plus psi x plus one minus two psi x. I just add and subtract this term. And here I will add two cosine. Let's temporarily assume that ky is zero. Then it is two cosine of bx minus two psi x is equal to epsilon psi x. And I have just rewritten my equation, but now this thing is approximately for smoothly varying wave function is second derivative. And this thing is approximately just b squared x squared, or maybe minus b squared x squared psi is equal to epsilon psi. So in the limit of small magnetic field, I can replace my discrete equation on a lattice by some continuous differential equation. And this equation is very, very easy to solve. So again, what I have done, I have this tight binding model, which is periodically modulated. It's also is called Abrea-Abrea-Harper model, but not so important. And in the vicinity of minimum or maximum, I can approximate my cosine by a parabola. So something like this, it's a parabola approximation, another parabola approximation. And for a parabola, I know energy level. So basically, my energy spectrum will be a lattice, will be consist of a ladder of levels. And they are called Landau levels for this problem. So epsilon n will be proportional to b and n. And n is just the number of levels. So 1, 2, 3, etc. So my energy spectrum for given magnetic field will be this ladder of levels. This will be proportional to B. Or I can also draw energy spectrum as function of magnetic field. This is energy, this is magnetic field, and I will get like a fan of levels. It's even people call it Landau fan. So fan like a ventilator. So it goes over, I am not sure. So it goes like this. I have a set of Landau levels. And they describe a spectrum of this problem. So in the regime of small magnetic field, I have Landau levels, and they are all equidistant, and they all change linearly with magnetic field. So this was all for small magnetic field. Now I want to consider the regime of large magnetic field. So what will happen with Landau levels? But maybe there are some questions. So I understand that it's rather simple problem, but still. So we have my electron on a lattice in a magnetic field. In a weak magnetic field, the spectrum is a ladder of discrete levels. So this was known, and this was obtained by Landau, I think, in 1928, but actually Landau solved this equation. So the equation on top was solved much later and only numerically. By the way, feel free to ask questions by voice and not by chat. Otherwise, I'm thinking that everybody is already away or asleep. So why there is no AX component, it's just a matter of gauge. So I can always select a gauge in such way that it's only AY. So I'm using Landau gauge where vector potential is along Y, but it changes along X. I could have used another gauge and obtained the same result, but it would be more difficult. This is Landau gauge. So what I want to do now, I want to solve the same green equation, but in the regime where magnetic field is large. And for real crystals, what does mean magnetic field is large? It means that the radius of the orbit of electron in magnetic field is on the order of lattice constant. So Vanya, thank you. So that's a good question, actually. This will be plus. Yeah, Maxim, you caught me. That's nice. Thank you. So yeah, indeed. Here has to be plus. And it means that there will be some constant. I think, well, okay, it means that maybe there will be some constant and epsilon plus two. I think it will be something like this. Basically, I approximate my cosine by a parabola. And it means that I have to also use some shift. So indeed, this is second derivative, that's correct. But here it's plus. So there is some additional term, but it doesn't change anything. It's just some reference point for energy. So I think it's not a problem. Just in the regime of small magnetic field, these two terms describe motion and they become a second derivative plus constant. So it's not a problem. But you caught me, thank you very much. So indeed in this equation, there is some shift of energy. So it is Bn plus some constant. That's correct. Okay, so let's move again to the Harper equation, which is on a lattice. So it's a discrete equation. And it's much more difficult to analyze it analytically. But what people started to do in 60s, they just put it in computer and solved it on a lattice. It's very easy. You just take some 100 sites and take the eigenvalues of this matrix. Not very complicated. And what people got was a very, very interesting result. They got that Landau levels split for large magnetic fields. So they stopped being just levels and they stopped being degenerate levels, they split. This thing has a very simple explanation in principle, because I have here this cosine potential, and in each well of this cosine potential, I have this parabola. So here parabola, here parabola, maybe somewhere else also a parabola. So in each parabola, I have a ladder of levels. And in this parabola, I also have a ladder of levels for an oscillator. But if magnetic field becomes large, these two parabolas start coupling to each other, and I get the splitting. So this parabola, in fact, applies in every well of the cosine potential. So this level starts splitting with this level. They degenerate in case of small magnetic field, and the number of degeneracy is proportional to the length of the crystal. But then they split for large magnetic field. So the problem is like this. I have this parabola. There are some, okay, not very horizontal. There are levels. Now there is another parabola. There are also levels. And they are equidistant. But if magnetic field is large, these levels begin talking to each other. And the spectrum Landau levels split. So what will be the result? The result will be so-called Hofstadter butterfly spectrum, and I'm going to show it now. I have it somewhere prepared. So yes, now, so as usual, the prediction of this Hofstadter butterfly, as usual, was not done by Hofstadter. It was done by Mark Asbel, working in Kapitsa Institute in Moscow, 12 years before Hofstadter. But Hofstadter did the numerical calculation and Asbel did the analytics. So Lёша Юлин, so could you just ask your question like in a by voice? I don't understand it otherwise.
Yes, I mean that if we consider a sequence, well, actually the potential is periodic, and it means that any Landau level should split into a zone, and we must have a periodic dispersion characteristics.
Yes, that's correct. But actually, it's even worse.
Not a discrete Landau levels, it will be a continuous spectrum. Landau levels split into a zone.
You are halfly right. So what you say is correct if the period of the cosine is commensurate with the period of the lattice. Then it's periodic system. But actually it can be incommensurate. So it is even worse. So the problem, if say for rational values of magnetic field, this cosine is commensurate with the lattice. Mm-hmm. So for some Russian students, so commensurate is соизмеримый. So the ratio of the period of magnetic field, the ratio of 2 pi over b is either a rational value or not. And if it's incommensurate, the problem is very, very complicated. But the answer is given in this poem by Hofstadter. So I will first give you the answer. And okay, so he basically says that what happens if you apply magnetic field to a crystal? What will be the spectrum? And the answer is that everything depends on the fact if magnetic field is rational or not rational. If it is rational, and if magnetic field is equal, say B is equal to 2 pi P over Q, where P and Q are P, Q are, how you call it, integer. Then you get Q allowed bands because of the splitting of Landau level. Otherwise, you get a counter spectrum, which is, as complicated as it gets. Actually, you can see the result as a background of my screen. So if I move a little bit, you see what happens, and I will show now. So
and how does the eigenfunction look like? It's not commensurable.
They are. I have to be accurate. So I think you get generally, if you have a counterset spectrum, you have two kinds of wave functions. Like in the band gap, it still decays exponentially, but your allowed bands form a counterset spectrum. And then probably you might get some power dependence and some fractal wave functions and everything. So what is shown here is this spectrum. This is energy, this is magnetic flux, and it is linear in magnetic field for small magnetic field. So here it is this Landau fan. And then this line split. And it's becoming, it's a fractal. For every integer number of magnetic flux, it's you get some allowed bands. Say, I think this is, what is it? So this is 1/2. So for 1/2, you get, I think, either 1 or 2. Okay, you have one band for 1/2. And for 1/3, you have 3 bands. So this is 1/3. You have 1, 2, 3 bands, and etc. So it's a very, very rich spectrum. Now, what is interesting is that in the white regions, you get edge states in this system, because it's still a problem of electron in magnetic field. So it's a quantum Hall problem. So you get this topological edge states between the states in the bulk. So between these Landau levels, you get also topological edge states, and you get a lot of them. So by topological edge states, I mean that my electron sort of moves around the edge of the sample, and nothing can stop it. So it's a so-called skipping orbit. Even if there is some impurity or sharp corner, it will still move, say, here it moves counterclockwise or no clockwise in magnetic field. So you get this spectrum, which is fractal, and you also get H states between every Landau levels. Do I have somewhere this more beautiful way of this butterfly? Well, I guess no, but on the background, if I just move a little bit, you see the same butterfly, but colored, and colors correspond to band gaps, and they are basically, they encode Chern numbers, I would say like this. So it's a very, very rich topological structure in a very simple problem. And well, this was an introduction into quantum Hall phase and Hofstadter butterfly. So if you take an electron on a periodic quadratic lattice and apply magnetic field, you get a fractal spectrum. Moreover, for this, you even don't need magnetic field. You can just apply any periodic potential. So if you have a problem on a lattice and you apply periodically modulate the energies, then you get, then your problem can be exactly mapped to the quantum Hall phase. It's just mathematically equivalent. So my modulation acts in the same way as magnetic field. So this was an introduction, and if there are no more questions, or probably I hope there are, but in principle, then I will move to some more original part of the talk. So because I want to do now the same, but from interactions. I want to show the same results, but instead of applying external magnetic field, I will use interactions. And what I will do? I want to consider a problem with this Hamiltonian. So this is my waveguide. And in the waveguide, I have closely spaced atoms. So distance, no, this is terrible. So distance is much smaller than the wavelengths. D is much smaller than lambda. And this is my Hamiltonian. It's pretty much standard. Basically, you have atoms. Two-level atoms, you have photons, and you have some standard coupling. This Hamiltonian has been written, I guess, by Dirac 80 years ago, or not 80, it's almost, I think, 90 years ago. So they wrote such Hamiltonians long, long time ago. But apparently it has not been analyzed that much in the space, how to say, for double excited states. So what was known for this system? So people considered this system in different regime. They considered it when atoms are all in one point, and then everything has been done. And a lot has been done by Dicke, who predicted superradiance in this problem, and people use this in lasers and in many, many setups. People also considered this problem for classical light, independent on the spacing between the atoms. And a lot also has been done there, and radius has been written. What has not been done? People have not analyzed, practically not analyzed before last year, the two particle excitations in this problem in the regime when spacing between atoms is not zero. This has not been analyzed. I don't know why, basically nobody was interested. And we want to do it. So what is known for this system? Well, in my system, I have atoms interacting with light. So eigenmodes are just polaritons. So I can draw energy spectrum. Maybe I will use black line. So this is energy. This is wave vector. No, this is, okay, sorry, I am trying. Okay, this is wave vector. This is atomic resonance, omega zero. This is light dispersion, CK. And due to the coupling, I get some anti-crossing. So I will get two polariton branches. And K extends up to pi over D, which is the edge of the brilliant zone. So these are my two polaritonic branches. And what I want to do, I want to put two polaritons in the lower branch. So I want to consider two particles in this system. So I put one polariton here and another polariton here, and I let them interact. What I mean by interaction? So interaction is already within this model. Interaction happens because one atom cannot be occupied twice. Interaction. So if I have a two-level atom, I can excite it once and get polariton. I can excite a neighboring atom, also get a polariton, but I cannot have two polaritons in the same point. So it's like a contact repulsion. So this atom is in the ground state. This atom will be also in the ground state, but one atom cannot be excited more than once. It's so-called photon blockade. So in my system, two polaritons cannot sit on the same side. This is very, very important. This is where interaction comes from. So basically, interaction happens because I have two-level atoms. And this can be realized very well for superconducting qubits or for cold atoms. I cannot excite one atom twice. So it means that my polaritons will have some repulsion. I can talk on that. This is a problem with short range repulsion. Repulsion. So this is the formulation of the problem. I have my waveguide closely spaced. In waveguide, I have polaritons. I put two polaritons in the lower branch, and they can interact with each other because my atoms are two levels. Basically, I can also show very, very quickly like the Hilbert states of this problem. So I have, say, ground state for four atoms. So all atoms are in the bottom level. Now I have single excited states. So I have four atoms, so I have four states like this. They are all single excited. Here, first atom is excited, here, second, here, third, here, fourth. And in this talk, I'm interested in double excited states, where two atoms are excited, but I don't know which of the two ones. So I have, say, n on the order of n squared double excited states. And I want to study the eigenstates of my system, double excited eigenstates of my system. I don't apply any external field. I don't apply any pump. I just study double excited states of this atomic array. What's also important maybe for the problem is that the coupling between atoms is very, very long range. So coupling between the atoms is because of light. Coupling is mediated by photons. So every atom can, say, emit photon. Photon will fly in the waveguide and it will end up here. Or maybe I'll better draw it. Okay, it will end up here. So I get from this state to this state. And I have this long range coupling between atoms because of photons. So this is the formulation of my problem. Now I'll just show you the main idea, which is very, very simple. The main idea is like this. If two polaritons interact, they can create potential for each other. And this potential can be periodic in a finite array, because eigenmodes in the finite array are standing waves. So my single particle eigenmodes in this system in a finite array behave as a standing wave. So the probability to excite given atom will be proportional to the cosine of the number of this atom. So it will be something like this. Some cosine of kx. So this is a single particle solution, but I want to consider two particle solution. So I add another particle. I add my first particle, say, has a wave function like this, and then I add another particle to the same system. And due to the interaction, one of the particles will induce a periodic potential for another one. So it's like a central point. And what is very, very important is that these two particles actually are indistinguishable. So these are both same polaritons. So, but first particle induces potential for second one, and second one at the same time induces potential for the first one. So it's like this very, very interesting game. It's not a particle in external potential, it's a self-induced potential. So it is self-induced by interaction. So, and what I can say is that one of my particles is a standing wave. It has a relatively low wave vector, and it's low and well-defined. And it creates a potential for particles with larger wave vectors. And since this potential will be periodic, it is very, very interesting. So I can, it's actually kind of hard mass. So if you want to do analytics in the system, it's complicated because you have this long-range coupling. So it's not so easy. But we were able to derive an equation that describes two particles in this system, and it is written here. So I have my two particle wave function like this. It is cosine times something plus something times cosine, because it's bosonic and it is two particles are indistinguishable. And this psi zero is fixed. Is just a single particle state. But the state chi is strongly modified by interaction. It's strongly, strongly modified by interaction, by the fact that two polaritons cannot sit in the same point. And if I write an equation for chi, it will be like this. So there will be some external potential in this equation due to psi zero. So I have one polariton which digs a potential, digs a lot of potential wells for another one. And this potential is periodic, which is very, very interesting. So, and this is self-induced periodic potential from interaction. So Sasha, I have then, to emphasize. Lёша, да?
Yeah, Sasha, but then I have the following question. So, can you search all two particle wave functions in this form? Because in fact, this is some ansatz, yes? You just postulated.
Maxim, it's a very good question. Maybe next slide I will answer. So I would say that most of them are described with this ansatz, but some of them are not. So in this ansatz, you can describe, well, you already see that it's like the problem for electromagnetic field. You can describe most of the states, some excepting states which behave like a quantum chaos. So there are states in the system which looks like a quantum chaos. It's not described by this ansatz. And there are also, so I don't know how to describe them. Maybe we have some specialists here who know how to deal with quantum chaos, maybe they will help us. And also there are states which are very strange. Their two interacting polaritons are what is called fermionized. So they describe like psi 1 at x, psi 2 at y minus. So it's like a slatter determinant. So some of the states behave like this, and they are not described by this ansatz. But I would say that 80% of the states are like this, because I have many, many single particle standing waves, and each standing wave creates some potential. and this potential acts as a magnetic field. And this is extremely interesting. This is even more beautiful, I would say, than conventional quantum Hall effect. Because, so what you see is that interaction induces periodic potential. It's also periodic, so we will see that there are Landau levels and analog of Hofstadter butterfly and states and everything here. But you even don't need to tune magnetic field. In order to see Hofstadter butterfly in conventional system, you need to tune magnetic field. You need to measure something, change magnetic field, measure again. Here, everything is already present in the system because you have many standing waves with different periods. And every period corresponds to different effective magnetic field. So most of the states in the system are quantum Hall states in different magnetic fields, so with different periods. This is very interesting. So in order to measure Hofstadter butterfly in this system, in principle, you even don't need to change magnetic field. It's present in one sample for fixed conditions. You don't have to tune the sample. It's already everything there. It's very unique. I spoke to many people who work in many body physics. So far, I have not found anything similar in any of the works on many body topological states, on topological photonics, nonlinear topological photonics. I have not seen anything like that, but maybe just have to look more. So let me move further. And basically, this is one of our main results. So it's a result of numerical calculation. It's energy spectrum for one sample. So you have one structure with 200 atoms. You have there 200 times 200, about, 40,000 states. And then you have to sort them carefully depending on the number of the standing wave. Each standing wave corresponds to some magnetic field. And I get this analog of Hofstadter butterfly just for one sample. So what I see here, red means localized states. So for a weak magnetic field, or say for weak number of the standing wave. So if my standing wave does not change fast, so if it's like this, I have Landau levels. And I have H states. So these are my Landau levels. And these are Landau levels. And these are H states. Because they are red, red means stronger localization. Now, if I increase magnetic field, so if I go to states where one of the standing waves has higher wave vector, my Landau level split. So, Andrei, could you ask it not in the chat, the definition of what?
Localization degree.
Well, I think it's just inverse participation ratio of the wave function. But basically, you have a two-particle wave function, and then you can calculate the probability that one of the particles is close to the edge.
Okay, in terms of the lattice constant?
Yeah, because I have 200 atoms, so okay, I say my first five atoms are close to the edge, and my last five atoms are close to the edge. So if one of the particles is close to the edge, I call it an edge state. So it's like this. And I can show you what I mean by, say, some numerical calculation. So here I show you what happens for spectrum, say, for one number of the standing wave. So I describe the states, which are like this. Cosine kx, psi y plus cosine ky, psi x. And what we did, we calculate everything rigorously. Then we did a Fourier analysis of the states to check that the ansatz works. It actually works pretty well. So we can obtain effective magnetic field that corresponds to every standing wave. And I now consider given value of magnetic field. So what you see, we have this ladder of Landau levels, and in between we have H states. And if I show the two particle wave function, my H states looks like this. So this is coordinate. So my two particle wave function, its amplitude, depending on the coordinate of first and second. Yeah, Nikita writes what is the definition in the chat. So in the axis corresponds to coordinates of first and second photon. So here I have 120 atoms, 125, I think. So wave function looks like this. Red is always close to the edge. So either first particle is close to the edge or second particle is close to the edge. And this modulation is just because of the standing wave. So again, it's what is extremely important for this work is that modulation is not induced externally. So I don't know very well recent literature on nonlinear topological states, but the works I know, you always have to do something special. You need to prepare some potential or some nonlinear special nonlinearity, which is periodic, and then something magically happens. But here it happens naturally. So this modulation is just one of the eigenstates of this system. And I have many eigenstates corresponding to many different periods of the modulation. And for each of them, I get this kind of H states. So this is my topological H. Yeah.
But then I have the following question. Would this mechanism work for the two particle H states? Because I can see that this reasoning works for single particle H state, since the second one creates cosine potential, but would this work for two particle H state?
No idea. So I think you need to consider triple excited states, and maybe then you will get those. So you will not get corner states by this mechanism. This yes. You will not get, surely. Mm-hmm. You will get single particle H states in a two particle domain. Maybe you will get two particle H states in three particle domain.
Yeah, that's clear. Mm-hmm.
Something like this. So we were not looking for this, but it somehow happened. So it turns out that this system is very, very rich. Maybe I will just show my last figure because I am already running out of time. So we did a lot, but just to show you, so we were very, very surprised. Actually, this problem should have been solved 70 years ago, but surprisingly, no. So what happens in this system? I will just show you different kinds of states that are possible. So even don't look at the spectrum in the center. So it's a complex spectrum for two particles, but it's not so important. What is important are different types of the wave function. So in the same system, in the same sample, say of 200 atoms, if you analyze the eigenstates, what will you get? Well, you will get scattering states, which are typical for this problem. Basically, for this scattering states, two particles don't talk to each other, so they are independent. It looks like this. It's a superposition of standing waves. This is trivial, and this has been known in this community at least, I think, for 50 years. What has been shown by Klaus Mollmer only last May is that you have a Fermionized states where the sign is minus. So because of the strong repulsion, two polaritons start behaving like fermions. And wave function looks like this. It has zero at the diagonal. This has been also known. What also has been known is a super radiant state where basically wave function is strongly symmetric. This is known. So what we have discovered in last autumn, and it's published in recently already, was states which behave like a cross. So one particle creates a potential for another one, and the other one becomes strongly localized, so localized just at one atom. And now we kind of move this idea further. So we can consider the states where one of the particle is in a standing wave with many nodes, and it creates a quantum Hall phase for another particle. And there you will get H states, which behave like this, and you will get Landau levels, which behave like this. Somewhere in the middle between this quantum Hall phase and this phase of fermions, you also have something like a quantum chaos. So I'm not a specialist in chaos or in non-linearity, but for me it looks like some sort of regular chaos, because it does not look well. You ask the question, how well does my ansatz work? Well, for this state, it does not work at all. It does not. It is not described as a product of two standing waves. It's something much more complicated. So we were very, very surprised. This problem of double excited states in atomic arrays looks very simple, but it is dramatically more rich than the problem for single particle states in atomic array. And it is also much richer than the problem without a waveguide, because for the problem without a waveguide, when you just have nearest neighbor hopping, you don't have any of this. Because, the reason is that for this effect, you need a very flat dispersion. So this is energy, this is wave vector, and in order for such beautiful physics, what you need is you need very quasi-flat band. No, sorry. And polaritons near the resonance have a quasi-flat band. So here, my band is practically flat polaritons. And because of this quasi-flat bands, effect of interactions become very, very strong. They are much stronger than in the conventional system. And effects of interactions lead to quantum Hall phase, lead to quantum chaos, lead to fermionization, lead to interaction-induced localization. So I will just end here, and thank you for your attention. So that's it.
Thank you, Sasha.
Many more pictures.
But we can use this in the chat. Applauding you. Okay, so do we have some questions? If not, let me start with the first question. So you demonstrated that actually in this system you have both two particle states with kind of bosonic statistics, as well as two particle states with fermionic statistics. But then I don't quite understand how you get these both types of statistics in the same system. Could you explain this a bit more?
Yeah, I think I can. So first I consider the situation with fixed number of excitations. So it's always two. And if it's always I have two excitations, the statistics is not very well defined. But to be more precise, I can write what I mean by fermionized state. So exactly what Klaus Molmer means. So the states that I'm interested in behave like this. Psi nm is, so these are bosonic states and it is symmetric. So this is certainly as bosonic as it gets. This is V, so to say. V. Now fermionized states, so Molmer fermions. The wave function still has to be symmetric because I still consider two interacting bosons. But it's fermionized, which means that it behaves like this. So psi nm is equal to basically Okay, the first there was a misprint.
I think. Okay, so I got this. It just fermionized for m larger than n, but then
yeah, it fermionized for n larger than m. Yeah, exactly. So it's kind of bosonic, but it has zero at the diagonal, and that's why it is. So yeah, it's anyway, still bosonic, but because of the zero at the diagonal, the square of the wave function looks the same as it would be for interacting fermions. So okay, the square of the wave function is the same as for fermions, just you have to adjust the phase. And there is even a theorem that for a parabolic spectrum of interacting bosons, ground state will always be like this. And Molnar knew it. We were uneducated and we did not know it. That's why we looked for other states. So why this fermionization does not happen in our system? Because we consider other part of the spectrum where it is not parabolic. So maybe I will shut up very soon. Just show you the spectrum of polaritons. So this is my lower polaritonic branch in very strange scale. So it is here, it behaves like light. So it first starts as light, then it shifts here, and then it becomes parabolic near k equal to pi over d. So near the edge of the Brillouin zone, the spectrum is parabolic. And here you get fermionization. But for instance, here, it's not parabolic and you get quantum hole. What might be super interesting is to consider the system that Misha Petrov invented, where they have K4 singularity at the edge of the Brillouin zone. Maybe there the same will happen. Well, yeah, I expect even more interesting physics here.
Mm. Okay, so and do we have some other questions? If not, then I have the second one. So are you thinking about some experimental verification, let's say with arrays of qubits in a waveguide? So some maybe strategies to experimentally probe such quantum hole phase?
We are, and it's very hard because I talked to experimentalists who are working with superconducting qubits, and as soon as the number of qubits gets larger than 10, they start to be very, very, get afraid of. So in order to see this quantum hole phase, we need at least 30 qubits, so 3-0. And for that, well, if you work in Google, then maybe you can do this and you can measure it. If you just have a very, very good group in a university, I'm not sure that this is so easy. So maybe in 5 years, so we have some ideas who can measure it. Maybe in 1 year, in 2 years, but it's not so easy. What can be measured relatively easier is not the quantum hole phase, but the states like this, where you don't get localization at the edge, but you get localization at the center, which is also pretty weird. It's interaction-induced localization at the very small special scale. So one particle digs a well for another particle and it gets localized just at one lattice site. So for this, you need maybe 15 qubits. So 1.5, not 5.0, but just 15 qubits. And this, I guess, might be, hopefully we convince someone to observe it in maybe next year, but well, okay. What's very nice is that this experiment with qubits people can measure even in the time of coronavirus. Our colleagues in Karlsruhe are measuring from home because you just use electric circuit, as far as they told me, because it's electric circuit. and you can just control it externally. It's electric circle in the cryostat. So who knows?
But then the question, why do you get these limits of 30 and 15 qubits? Is this some fundamental limitation? I believe you can play with parameters.
Not really. Maxim, not really. So 15 is not a fundamental limitation. It's just how much qubits do you need to say that your state is localized. So if you have 2 qubits, then what does mean by localization? It is never localized.
If you have 5,
so you need at least 10. Maybe you need to have 5, but also you need to have very well-defined lower polariton branch. You need to have enough state there. Maybe 5-10 qubits, you can see this thing. In order to see quantum Hall phase, you need to have high-order standing wave. So you need to see well-defined standing wave that has many nodes, say this. And for that, you need, I think, maybe 20 qubits, maybe 30, but not 10. So my most optimistic idea will be that you need 10 qubits for this and 30 qubits for this. And Google have 54, and some of our colleagues in China, they have about 30. So it is within the realm of measurable, but of course it's hard, it's a many body quantum experiment. Who knows?
Okay, so a question from Roman.
I just wanted to clarify about this dispersion, polariton dispersion with 2 branches. So it does not describe eigenstates because they can interact with each other in this system. And when does it actually describe like non-interacting eigenstate for this array of 2-level systems? Only when you have a single photon, single excitation in the system?
Roma, thank you very much. It's a very, very good question. So this dispersion is, okay, where is it? Maybe I have it somewhere here. Okay, so do you see it on your screen?
Yes, yes.
So it's, first it starts as a light and then it gets flat. Now I have to consider finite system, so my wave vector is quantized, like pi over d times n. And it means that here the spacing between the levels is large, or the density of states is low. And because of the low density of states and the large spacing between the levels, effects of interaction here are weak. So here it works. For standing wave, actually it works. Single particle works. But here I have a quasi-flat band. And in case of flat band, or in another word, slow group velocity, effects of interaction are very strong. So for this dispersion in the for large wave vectors, interaction is very important, and it modifies the spectrum. And for low wave vectors, it is not so important. That's why my states look like a standing wave. And that's why my eigenstates is a product of these two. So one particle is a well-defined standing wave, and another one is something very special. So it's
so,
like this.
So they interact only in finite systems.
Well, in infinite, they also interact, but I don't know actually well what. Well, in infinite system, you get, you can say like this. So it's very important that system is finite. In infinite system, physics is different. In infinite system, you get scattering states and 2-particle bound states, like by accidents, but you don't get this. What else? Had somewhere very nice picture, but maybe I lost it, and maybe it's for the good, otherwise we will never end.
Last questions. What defines the line, so like delta omega, of these modes, these states?
Well, in principle, they all have radiative decay, so they can escape into the waveguide.
Mm-hmm.
But for this physics, it's not important because the radiative decay is determined by a single particle state. So radiative, so for instance, I have some standing wave in a finite array. It will have some decay. Then this state will interact with another state, but the decay will stay the same. So here, all this physics of dark and bright states for localization so far does not seem to be very important.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe I have one last figure, just I consider it so beautiful that I will show you even though you have not asked. Yep. So, okay, so I have two particle states and they can be described by two wave vectors. And here both wave vectors are small. And here they are equal, say, to pi over d in the right corner. So, for instance, in the top right corner, I have states of Molnar, which are behave like fermions. So here are fermionic states. Here is decay state, where both wave vectors are small. Now, this is our cross-like state when one of the particles is localized at the center. So one of the standing waves, one of the particles has relatively small wave vector, and another one has large. And this is the quantum Hall phase, so it's somewhere here. So the Hilbert space of two excitations in the system is extremely rich. You have, like, if you have two wave vectors, you have many corners in this Hilbert space, and in different corners you get different states. So you get dark states, you get chaos, you get interaction-induced localization, you get quantum Hall, and it all appears naturally from interaction.
Okay, thank you, Sasha. So I suggest that we thank our speaker. Yes, and with that, we finish today's seminar. Thank you, Sasha.
Thank you, Maxim.